Today I want to talk about a subject that is frankly universal for anyone. It doesn't matter the culture, it doesn't matter what language you speak or what time of human history you live in. The subject I want to talk about today is always there. It's always the issue that's being raised. It was raised in philosophy, it was raised in literature, it's been raised in politics, in education, in the arts. It's been a question that is raised in every sphere of life, in every culture, and in every place that humans have ever walked this earth. And the question I want to talk about is, how do I change? How do I become different than I know I am? How do I take the things that I find so unlovable about myself, the things that make me feel embarrassed about myself, the things I probably wouldn't tell anyone about. How do I get change in those areas of my life? Maybe it's anger, maybe it's lust, maybe it's envy, maybe there's a root of bitterness in your life about something from the past or even right now. Maybe it's a lack of joy. It could be any of a number of different things. But there's always this question sort of hanging out there with every people group and in every sphere of life, which is, how do I change? And the strategies that have been employed to try to change are pretty numerous, but they all seem not to work. If any of them ever worked, then the self-help section would simply evaporate. We'd all find the one thing that always makes us change out there in the world. But we seem to write more and more books and have more and more strategies about how to change, and they don't seem to work. One of the things I had to do, frankly, was forced to do for the doctorate, was I had to dabble and learn a number of different languages, some old, some new. And one of the things that surprised me as I always looked at them is, you know, you're going through, you're learning, you know, where is the library, please, in every language, and you sort of, where is the toilet, please, and you're always learning these simple phrases. And as you sort of progress further into learning the grammar and learning the words and sort of learning how people use their languages around the world, it always surprised me that every single language that I've ever looked at least always has a phrase or a written syllable or something that has no real meaning, but it just simply expresses the sigh of life. In English, it might be the word O-H. O doesn't actually refer to any specific thing. It's not a noun, it's not a verb, it's just this exclamation of a sigh. And in German, there's a different one. In Greek, there's a different one. In Latin, there's a different one. And I just noticed, century after century, language after language, every culture just has this sigh, which I take in this context to mean, why can't I change? What is it about me that is hanging on to something that I know is poisonous? Something that is making me feel as if I can't even enjoy the life that the Lord has given me. There's something holding me back. And so what in the world, if God is true, what in the world does he want me to do to change? And the answer, one of the answers that I find in Scripture, comes from 1 John 3. 1 John chapter 3, beginning at verse 1, reads, "See what kind of love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared, but we know that when He appears, we shall be like Him, because we shall see Him as He is. And everyone who thus hopes in Him purifies himself as He is pure." And then down at verse 16 it says, "By this we know love, that He laid down His life for us, and we ought now to lay down our life for others. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or in talk, but in deed and in truth." If you just sort of take those verses at a surface level, I think probably the things that always jump out in our minds are, in fact, I could probably take a poll on this or do a survey certain type of an experiment, I think. Take a room about this size. If you were to take those verses, just sort of have them on a page, and then ask someone to write down what they notice. And I would guess it's probably true in this room as well, as I read those. Among the things that probably grabbed your attention, that grabbed your mind, were the words, "Everyone who hopes purifies himself." There's probably a red flag that went up there. I'm not purifying myself. I better get on something. I better do certain things. There was something missing in my life. I better purify myself. And then down in the second section that I read, the phrase is that if you have the world's goods and you see someone in need, give. Or that we are told in verse 16 that we should lay down our lives for others. In other words, I just read a bunch of verses to you that talk explicitly about God's love for us. And yet there's something in us, something in our hearts, something in our mind that probably first recognizes and latches on to the things that we think we ought to do for God first. That I ought to do things, I ought to give, I ought to sacrifice, I ought to do things. Give of my money, give of my time. Spend more time in prayer. Spend more time doing things. The kind of transactional life, you know, I'm going to pay God certain things. My time, my money, my energy, my talents. And that what will then happen if I do that, says our natural human default position, if I do things for God, what? He'll do things for me, maybe. That we end up treating God as if he is some bank teller in the sky. I need more deposits and fewer deductions for God to be okay with me. I don't need to be in the red with God. But actually, if you read these verses again more slowly, you'll see that what John has said here is the exact opposite of what you might have heard when you read those verses. He begins, actually, in verse 1, he says, "See what kind of love the Father has given us." That's actually a newer translation. If you go to the King James Version, it says, "Behold what love the Father has given us." The opening in the Greek is this kind of exclamation point, sort of pounding the fist. Wake up! See what kind of love God has given us. So all of this talk about purity, all this talk about change that John is saying here, how do I change? Well, the first thing he actually says is, who cares about you changing first? See what love the Father has given you already, even without change. He loved you first. God loved you first. He died for you first. You didn't change one iota before he loved you. And in fact, the opening sort of frames the whole thing. It says, God loved you first. You didn't love him first.